Alright, so today we're going to start talking about non-parametric tests, and we're going to, in the class, looking at one particular type of non-parametric test, the Wilcoxon. There's several variations of the Wilcoxon. We're only going to get through one today, thanks to the limited time that we have. We'll get into non-parametrics, talk about different types of data, cover the first of the Wilcoxons, and we'll do the next class. Okay, so what's a parameter? We've talked about parameters before. Mean of a population is a parameter, right? A parameter, what does it describe? The mean of a population tells us something about the population, right? Are there other parameters? Variance of the population. If you know the variance of a population and the mean of a population, then you can start doing interesting things. If you know more things about the population, like the distribution shape, if it's normal, you can do other things as well. So parameters are basically, sir, I'm sorry?
Number of populations is a parameter?
Sample size. So we have, for some of the things that we've used sample sizes. For the binomial, the sample size is actually a parameter, right? So for other things like our F-tests, it wasn't the sample size that we were so concerned about, it was the degrees of freedom that we have. And the degrees of freedom told us which F distribution that we were gonna use. Basically, a parameter is just some variable, some thing that defines a system. And it could be beyond a statistical system. But here we're talking about statistics and things. So we're talking about population parameters, parameters of distributions. So we know that a standard normal distribution, the parameter for the mean is 0 and the standard deviation is 1, right? We know some of those things. So binomial, we have things like the probability of success. That was one of the parameters for the binomial. The other was sample size. So the normal, we have the mean and standard deviation. If we know we have a normal distribution, if we say what the mean is and say what the standard deviation is, we basically know, we can calculate the probabilities exactly, right? If you think back to the functions p norm, all we had to tell it was some quantile and then the mean and the standard deviation for the population, and then we were able to get it. For chi-square and f, what were the parameters that we were working with? Degrees of freedom for both of them. All right, so what is a parametric test? Parametric.
Is that the
best parameters? Beautiful. Yeah, that's great. It's a test that depends on parameters. I need to revise this, because that's so much better than what I have. A test based on probability distributions for the dependent variables. The mean and the standard deviation, the probability of success and the sample size, right? We ran tests using those parameters. So all of the tests that we have talked about today, we have used parameters because we either know that they've come from a normal distribution or a binomial distribution, or we know that the sample size is sufficient to make those types of assumptions. All right, so for the binomial, the dependent variables coming from the binomial distribution. Binomial can also be used non-parametrically. We may talk about this later, but not right now. And everything else we've talked about, the dependent variable is typically coming from a normal or approximately normal distribution. Okay, so what's a non-parametric test? A test that doesn't depend on the parameters as we've talked about before. At least not on the parameters that define probability distributions for the dependent variable. So tests that maybe don't require the dependent variable to be normally distributed or to be distributed according to a particular binomial or multinomial distribution. It's a test basically based just on the sample. So we don't need to compare the sample to population parameters. And this is what we'll be talking about for the remainder of the semester. So let's talk about some different types of data. What different types of data are there? Let's move on to some non-parametric tests. When we did t-tests, we had three types of t-tests, right? What were they?
One sample
t-test. Independent t-test. Paired t-test. Beautiful. All right, all of these was based on assumption that the dependent variable was normally distributed, right? What if it's not? Well, then we're not justified in doing the t-test, which is based on this assumption of a particular distribution, which is based on the parameters of a mean and standard deviation, right? So we're saying, huh, we can calculate the sample mean still, we can calculate the sample standard deviation still, but the distribution in our sample is so whacked out, so non-normal looking that we say, whoa, this does not seem normal. So maybe we shouldn't assume that we can, you know, estimate the population variance in the mean. Okay, so what do we do if it's not? Woo, Wilcoxon to the rescue. So this is typically used for unranked data that is interval scale. It is based on ranks. What type of scale are ranks? Nominal, ordinal, interval, or ratio? Ordinal, rank. You came in first. That's your rank. Came in second. That's your rank, right? So the Wilcoxon is going to be based on ranks. And what we're going to do is we are going to rank the data. We have the data, it's not from a normal population, or at least the probability that it's from a normal population is really, really low. So we're going to say, aha, we aren't justified using the t-test. Let's use that. Let's take ranks of those data. All right, so for the t-test, we have different Wilcoxon alternatives. So we have a one sample Wilcoxon sign ranks test. For our independent t-test, we have the Wilcoxon ranks sum test, which is very closely related to the Mann-Whitney-U. So if you see me ask a question based on the Mann-Whitney-U, what you're doing is the alternative to the independent t-test. Paired t-test, we have a Wilcoxon matched pairs signed rank test. Notice all of these, rank, ranks, rank. All of these are based on ranking your data. So how do you find ranks? Here's some data. How do you find the ranks? So we can rank them from highest to lowest, or lowest to highest. We can do it either way.
So the lowest one
is what? Okay, where's the lowest one?
4.5.
So that's one.
12.7,
so that will be?
No,
15.3. So it might be hard to sort of see like which one is highest and lowest. What we can do, if we have data like this, raw data in R, we can say sort the data and get the data that are sorted. And they have something like this, right? So 4.5 is the smallest, 6.2, that's the next smallest, 7.1, boom, our data is sorted. All right, now once we have our data sorted, how do we do the ranks? So this is rank, let's say we're going from low to high. One.
Two.
Three.
Four.
Five. Doesn't four come after five? Is it four? Is it five? Is it something else?
Four.
Four? Oh, what happened? So this one, the way it's here, we can say this is four and this one's five, but really these are the same, right? So when you have ties, typically what you do is you give the rank to the tie that's actually the average of the ranks that it goes over. So this goes over four and five, the average, the mean. Mean. So the mean of 4 and 5 is 4 and a half, right?
We have 4, 8.4. order. Not two, but four.
So we have to four, five, six, seven.
We have four.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand. What?
So she
said
that what
is
the next four are 8.4.
What are these next four or 8.4? So we have four, five, six. Let's just do three. Let's imagine that these three.
15 with the
bottom. So we have 4, 5, and 6, that's 15,
divided by
3 is 5. Yeah. So if we had another one, 4, 5, 6, 7,
22
divided by 4,
5,
all right. Just take the mean of the rings that it spans. Okay, so now what's next?
6.
Yes, 6. Okay, great. So the one sample Wilcoxon sine ranks test, the null, we can state it something like this. The population mean is whatever. Or we can say it's the population mean is greater than or equal to, or less than or equal to, just like we did with the one sample t-test, right? So here I just picked an arbitrary value for the hypothesized population mean, it's 8. Okay, so this is the null hypothesis. What we need to do is take the difference from each observed score and the hypothesized mean. This is somewhat similar to what we were doing for the chi-square, right? The difference between observed and expected. So we're getting the differences between the each observed score and the hypothesized mean, what we're expecting. Then we are going to take the absolute values of all of the differences. Then we're going to find ranks for the differences, and then we're going to sum the ranks for the scores that were above the mean. And the symbol for the sum of the ranks is V. Okay, so let's find the ranks. So here are the raw data, in order. I got rid of the 8.4 twice. Talk about why in just a minute. But notice that we have three of them beneath the mean, okay? Three of them, or the rest of them are above the hypothesized mean. Right? So I've color-coded them so we can see sort of what's going on. So, the absolute differences. What's the absolute difference between this and our hypothesized mean?
3.5 minus
negative 3.5, right? And then the absolute of that is 3.5. So the difference between 6.2 and the mean is negative 1.8, absolute value 1.8. So we can figure these things out. Not too difficult. Okay, now what are we going to do? Let's order it to make it easier. So let's sort them. So notice we had 3, 4, 3, 4, 9, 1.8, 2.9, 3.5, and then the rest of them are in order. Now that we have the sorted absolute differences, what we can do is get the ranks. So the ranks, 1, 2, 3, 4, blah. Now all we need to do is add up the sum of the positive ranks. So we have 1, 2, 5, 7, 8, 9, and 10. That gives us...
So why do we have negative ranks?
When will you have negative what?
Ranks.
You will never have negative ranks. So, I take that back. You can have negative ranks, but when you're ranking them, you rank them in the positive sense, right? So we have ranked them here. Now, which of these ranks are negative? The negative ranks are the red ones, which were beneath the mean. So these are the ones, even though we ranked them, right, we have all of the ranks which in value are positive, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all of those are positive. But three of those ranks come from the data that was beneath the mean, where that difference was negative, yeah.
No plus mean is 8, so it's equal positive and negative.
Once you know one, the This is similar to the degrees of freedom. Once you know what the positive ranks are, you already know what the negative ranks are. Right? I mean, once you know 1, 2, 5, 7, 8, 9, and 10 are the positive ranks, you already know what these are. I mean, what you are actually doing, you're comparing these ranks to these ranks, and you want to see if those are different from one another or not. If there is no difference, then the sums of those ranks should equal the same thing. Right? They will never typically in practice equal the same thing because of variations. But on average, they should equal the same thing if there really is no difference from the hypothesizing. But because one set of the ranks are given once you know the others, all we have to worry about in order to do the test are the positive ranks. Or the negative ranks, you can pick. You do the one, you know the other. Okay, so we have our sum of positive ranks. This is 42. Now what are we doing? Okay. We're not going to go through all of the steps. I'll quickly sort of walk you through it, but I'm not going to have you compute any of this. Because it's so, you know what I mean? Okay. To find the probability of observing the sum, so we found a sum that was 42, right? And when we've been doing statistics on things, we want to find the probability of something that one more extreme. Right? So we had an observed sum that was 42. So we need to add up the probabilities for each of the potential ranked sums that are greater than or equal to 42. And there are lots of them. How do we do this? We need to go back to our counting rules. What's the probability of any particular ranking? Well, we have 10 ranks, right? 1 through 10. So there are 10 ways that the ranks could be assigned. There are 10 factorial ways that those could be assigned. First one could get a 10, the next one could get a 2. We have all those different possibilities. So this goes way back to early on in the class. Each of the assignments of the different ranks has a probability of 1 over 10 factorial. So yeah, really, really tiny. So we need to add a whole bunch of things up. We have 7 positive ranks. N was 7. So there are 10 factorial divided by 7 factorial times 3 factorial. Do you guys remember this? So this was the N factorial over K factorial N minus K factorial. That's that. It's combinations. It's exactly right. So there are lots and lots of combinations of ranks that we could give to our 7 positive values, right? Now, not all of these will sum up to 142 or more. So if we had the ranks of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that only adds up to 28. So we're not going to be able to add up all of those. We're only going to add up some of those. There are also 10 to the factorial divided by 6, so basically this, for 6 positive observations, and some of those could add up to 42 or more. So if you had 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, and 2, that would add up to 42. That's just as extreme. That's fine. Let's do this the easy way. We know how to do combinations and permutations. We know how to add up probabilities. So we can figure out the answer. But since we know the mechanics, since we've covered the mechanics a lot early on in class, we don't need to go through them now. So let's use our Wilcox.test. Wilcox.test. Here it is. Wilcox.test for data. Mu equals hypothesized mean. The data is just the data of the vector of raw data. It's like T2, right? Test 2 scores. Are test 2 scores different from a mean of 60, right? We can do a Wilcoxon test. I'm going to give it the hypothesizing mean. So if we do this, we see that V equals 42. It's exactly what we calculated before. And what's the P value? P value is 0.16. We would fail to reject the null hypothesis if we were using the traditional alpha. Yes, okay, what if the ranks were tied? If the ranks are tied, so in the original data set I had tied ranks, We do the same thing here, and it tells us we do a continuity correction. So the p-value in Wilcox's test of fault cannot compute exact p-value with ties. So it does a correction. And how you would do this correction is beyond the scope of the class. The good news is R will do it for you. More options, just like t.test, Wilcox.test has other options, like mu. If you don't specify mu equals 8, what do you think it will do?
Zero.
Right. So if you want to do zero, all you have to do is say Wilcox test data. All right. Alternative? Two-sided, less, greater. Yay. Exact. Do you guys remember exact? Exact equals true?
Not exact.
Strict. Right. That was strict before. Strict equals true. Here, exact is the same type of thing. Use exact. Exact equals true. And we'll see some more in the next class where we'll talk about what happens for two seconds.